my pleasure to introduce Nathan Tenney. We'll be talking about the Grand Canyon Association. Without further ado, here's Nathan.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. The ancestral Pueblo called it Kaibab, or mountain lying down. The Spanish called it Grand Canyon, and John Wesley Powell named it Grand Canyon in 1872. Over 4,000 years, this area has been explored and enjoyed by many groups of people, but it wasn't until 1919 when it came under protection of the federal government. Beginning in the early 1900s, History.com notes commercial expansion and increasing tourism as the main drivers for making it a national monument in 1908. The Santa Fe Railway connected to the Grand Canyon Railway, which allowed millions of visitors to be able to start pouring in and more of the tourism and commercial industry to expand there. High concentration uranium mining was very popular in the early 1900s, which had to be stopped after it became a national park. Railroads that kind of brought more of the ranchers and prospectors to lead to more private development of the park instead of turning it over to the government. After visits from Theodore Roosevelt in 1903, he made it a national monument in 1908, which offered more protection for the park, but it was still being developed heavily by private companies, and many things were happening which were creating reservoirs and messing with the flows of the rivers through the canyons. And this laid the foundation for becoming a national park eventually in 1919. Of the park, he said, "In the Grand Canyon, Arizona has a natural wonder which is in kind absolutely unparalleled throughout the rest of the world. I want to ask you to keep this great wonder of nature as it now is. I hope you will not have any building of any kind, not a summer cottage, a hotel, or anything else, to mar the marvelous grandeur, the sublimity, the great loneliness, and beauty of the canyon. Leave it as it is. You cannot improve upon it. The ages have been at work on it, and man can only mar it." After becoming a national park, much of the development we see today started to unfold. Trails and projects were established. This includes mining and grazing activities being stopped below both the north and south rims. Many more hotels like the El Tovar and the Grand Hotel on the south rim were established. Expansion of the land areas under the original Forest Preserve guidelines were included, and Havasu Canyon was also given back to Havasupai Tribe Control in 1975. This leads me to my main point, which is about the Grand Canyon Association. This was started in 1932 by a park ranger, Eddie McKee. He worked there, and according to the association website, he saw the need for a park partner that would support funding for interpretive publications, educational research, and scientific studies. He was one of the more famous naturalists of this time, and he did a lot of geologic research below the rim. And eventually, this association is now the only and official sponsor of private funds to the national park itself. According to the National Park Service, the Grand Canyon Association has administrative costs and funds that have been instrumental to park projects and development. And these include some of the new South Rim Demonstration Gardens. It's a garden that displays the vegetation of the equivalent from Canada to Mexico, and it has every single type of plants and ecosystems displayed there. The Bright Angel Trail is one of the main corridor trails. There's four in the canyon, and this project's been going on for a while, but it should be finished in relatively soon. And every year they publish publications, educational studies, field institutes, and they have a lot of charities. They have a music festival every year that's really fun. They have search and rescue missions that they carry out. All these are funded through memberships, donations, and their online shop. They have a South Rim greenhouse that they recently just built. The national parks allow them to build a Matterhorn amphitheater on the South Rim. Not too much development's been going on the North Rim since it's closed usually from November to April because of winter weather can be pretty crazy. They have Field Institute service trips that they allow people to go and explore careers in land resource management. The Cobb brothers, Emery and Ellsworth, they've been a part of the history of the canyon for a long time, since the early 1900s. They were famous photographers that started some of the early artwork that was involved with the canyon. And this, once it got published, led to increasing tourism and people saw how beautiful it was. So after it was around for about 100 years, the Grand Canyon Association got a $500,000 grant from American Express to be able to renovate the whole studio, and it should be finished soon. And that's one of the main tourist destinations, along with Desert View Watchtower on the South Rim. And it's currently a 501c3 nonprofit. All the contributions are tax deductible. It's an independent organization, so if you donate to the Grand Canyon Association, none of the money is going to go towards other parks or other sites. It all stays within the National Park Service for that specific location. And why would you donate now? There's still about 350 miles of trails that need to be maintained and restored to their original standings. And there's a new Desert View Intertribal Heritage Area, which includes a monument and building for many of the tribal leaders. A dark skies project, which is supposed to reduce a lot of the lighting so you can see the Milky Way at night. It's one of the darkest places in the planet. At the bottom at night, you can see stars forever, and they want to keep it that way. And according to the National Park Service, it's been the single most important source of private research and development for the park for over 100 years. And in order to preserve and protect this natural wonder, I think we have a moral duty to contribute to these kind of organizations that are willing to educate and take the lead on protecting our land management. And I personally love the Grand Canyon more than any place on Earth, and I'd be devastated to see any kind of negative development that would harm the environment for generations to come in this place. And I would encourage you all to support this organization through any way possible, whether it's donations, volunteering, or possibly exploring a career in land resource management, because places like these are the ones that are the most danger of having negative development happen, so we need to protect these. And I'd like to leave you with a quote by former Arizona Senator Barry Goldwater, which I agree with. He said, "Well, once you've been in the canyon and you've sort of fallen in love with it, it never ends. It's always been a fascinating place to me. In fact, I've often said that if I ever had a mistress, it would be the Grand Canyon." Thank you.
Questions?
Will be the cause of not being able to see the Milky Way anymore. Are there other effects from that? Or
it's basically just for the aesthetic, for the views of it. I think they did a study a year ago, about 400,000 light bulbs in the North and South Rim on all the facilities and buildings they manage. Of them, I think 300,000 needed to be replaced to meet the standards that they want to keep light pollution down.
What made you choose?
I've always loved the Grand Canyon. I've been hiking there. I've hiked many miles. I've stayed there so many times. It's just been one of my greatest loves, and a lot of the conservation efforts have kind of come under attack by the federal government, so there are certain issues that need to be addressed with the future development of the park.
How many times have you visited the Grand Canyon?
4 times in total.
Timer.
I'm Josh Berger, and the time was 7 minutes and 20 seconds.
Okay.
I'm going to put something on, and I counted 7 annotations.
Sabrina, he had 5 ams and 2 us.
Okay.